that he would bear my cross. You would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for
the name above all names. Place, just lift your hands before the Lord today. Let's declare it in this place. Lord, you rule and reign. Have your way. Have your way in this place, Lord. Come on, lift your hands and sing. Our God reigns. Our God reigns. Forever your King. Come on, church, we're talking about the King of Kings. And the Lord of Lords, our God reigns. Yes,
our God reigns forever. Your kingdom reigns.
Come on,
our God reigns. Our God reigns forever. Your kingdom reigns.
Father, we bless you this morning because you're a God that's unlike any other. You are the one true living God. We just want you to know, Lord, that we recognize that this morning. They may talk about a lot of other gods, but oh, there's not one like you. Hallelujah. Our God reigns and he reigns supremely. There is none like him. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, there's no other God that can take a poor lost sinner, lift him from the miry clay and set him free. Hallelujah. Glory to God. There is no other God that rules over cancer and rules over sin and rules over diseases and rules over all of those things and can say to those things, be gone in the name of Jesus, and they'll be gone. Hallelujah. No other God ever carved out rivers and streams and built up mountains and designed all creation. Oh, that's our God, church. That's our God. What a great God you are. Glory to Jesus. Father, just come and have your way this morning. As great as you are, you can come down and you can meet us right at the point of our need. And so, Father, this morning I pray that the Holy Spirit would move in this place. I pray, God, that you're just going to work and walk these aisles. And, Lord, I pray that true life change will happen this morning. True healing will happen this morning because we let you have your way. If you want God to have your way, his way this morning in your life, just say amen. Come on. If you want God to have his way in your life, just say amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Do you believe God reigns this morning? Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's give him a shout of praise today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
So thankful for each of you that are here. Please take a moment and welcome our online congregation and thank them for being with us as well. I want to encourage you to do a couple things. One, if you have not yet, and those of you online, listen to me as well. If you have not yet, download our church app, Life Change Church app. If you go to your app store on your smartphone and look it up, download it. A lot of information. All the services are on there. Every week they download them on there, and you can listen to them over and over and over and over and over and over. Because I know you're going to. You'll probably skip right past the music straight to the preaching. I know that's what you're I'm only teasing. But whatever part of the service, that's kind of cool about that, you can highlight a certain part of the service, and if it ministered to you, you can go back to it. And I encourage you to download the app. Encourage your friends to download the app. We'll be putting more and more things on there. And it's a great, great ministry tool. Also, those of you online and everyone in the congregation, I want to encourage you to invite somebody wherever they live. Invite them to be a part of the services online. They can be part of Life Change Church wherever they are because we are live streaming every Sunday morning. And I know that a lot of people are tuning in, a lot of people are part of this, and God's moving in people's lives. And the Word of God never changes. And He can touch your life and change your life. So invite someone to be a part of that. Then, if you're here today, maybe you're visiting for the first time, or you're online for the first time, or you've been coming for some time, and you've not registered your email with us, I want you to do so. There's a number that's coming on the screen. And you can text that number, 513-900-8089. And give us your email or anything else you want to give us. And that way we can reach back out to you, and you'll get more information about the church. We're going to be, again, sending them for some time. We did regular emails, devotionals, and things like that. We want to start that back up, and it'll be a great source of encouragement to you. And those emails, by the way, when the devotionals come, the Bible things come, that's not junk mail. Don't get rid of it. God's going to be able to speak to your heart, and it's going to be a wonderful, wonderful tool. So please register your email with us. Just send us, text your email to us, and I know you'll be glad you did. I want to mention, too, starting in November, we're no longer having a Sunday night service, but we're having what we're going to call Wednesday Night Lift. That midweek, you know, sometimes you just need that hoist, that lift and help. And so Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock, well, at some point, I don't know if we'll be able to start it here with space. Definitely when we get in the new building over off of 275, but we're going to be having every Wednesday a dinner, something to eat. You can come from 6 to 7 anytime through there and bring your family, eat, and then go into the service. We'll try to keep the service about an hour. Of course, we'll never squelch the move of God. Whatever God wants to do, we're going to do what He wants to do. And if He wants to go to 10 o'clock, you can go home when you want. We don't lock the doors until you give. And just see if you're here. We don't lock the doors. And the doors will be unlocked, but we're going to try to keep it at an hour on Wednesday nights, because I know you have families and school and all those kind of things. But if God wants to move on, we'll follow the Holy Ghost. Say amen.
Amen.
So exciting stuff's happening at Life Change Church. I also want to real quick mention to you, go to Facebook and like Pastor Troy Ervin on Facebook. Soon, I'm going to have to probably do away with my personal Facebook account. I got 5,000 friends, and I can't accept any more. I had a bunch of people that were trying to be my friend the other day, and I really wanted to be their friend. I couldn't be their friend. Facebook won't let me be their friend. And it's just breaking my heart that I can't be their friend. So I'm just trying to encourage them to go and like me, and then we can be friends. All you got to do is like me, and then we'll be friends again. So go to Facebook and like the Pastor Troy Ervin, and that's a great ministry tool as well. A lot of information coming through that. Ushers, get in your place. Before you get there, I almost forgot. Come and share.
I just have a real quick testimony, and want to give God the glory. I believe God's mindful in even the small things in our life, because they're all big things to Him.
Amen.
My husband is in an industry that they have their peak seasons and they have their down seasons. And so accordingly, he has peak pay and he has regular pay. So we were getting close to the time, you know, where it was going to go down to not his normal pay, because it's not the company's peak season. And so therefore they typically adjust accordingly. And I'm not gonna lie, you know, as a family, we were worried. We were, you know, and it's hard to understand, you know. God, we're paying our tithes, we're faithful, you know. Why? We don't understand what's going on. So we just began to just pray about it. And I said, you know what, he's never left us. He's never not fed us when we're hungry in every aspect of our lives. And so we just began to pray and just say, you know, God, you're going to take care of us one way or the other.
Amen.
You know, you've always provided.
Amen.
And Daniel, this week, and I want you to understand, the leadership in the company, you know, as accordingly, they're very strict, they're very stingy with the money sometimes. So Daniel gets an email from the vice president of the company, and he says, we see how hard you've been working. We're keeping your pay the same. It's
Amen.
Not going to change.
That's
so,
right.
And this doesn't just happen. But God.
Amen.
He said, try me now and see if I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing.
Yes, he did.
It's not going to be big enough to receive. And I believe this was just a portion of what he has. So try him and see what he has.
That's good. Thank you for sharing that. Praise God. Amen. Yeah, let's give the Lord a praise. Father, I pray that you'll bless this offering, multiply it, and use it to glorify yourself. In Jesus' name, amen.
Savior died
suffered it all.
He suffered it all
because he loved me.
Because he loved me.
Well, praise God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, praise his dear name.
Say it again.
Oh, praise his dear name. He loved me so.
Praise God, praise God. Aren't you glad that Jesus died for us? Praise the Lord! Hallelujah to the Lamb! Glory to God! Hallelujah! Oh, praise God, praise God, praise God. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Well, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. The greatest liberty in the world is to celebrate the redemption that Christ bought and paid for on the cross 2,000 years ago. I want you to turn in your Bible with me this morning to 2 Chronicles chapter 18. And I want to spend a little time here this morning with a little different type sermon, I suppose you could say. I don't know how to say it, really. But I want to follow what I believe is the leadership of the Lord today. Before I get into this, I just want to say...
Praise you, Jesus.
I just want to say to you individually today, I want you to listen to me. Everyone listen to me. I want you to know today that it doesn't matter what you're going through in life. It doesn't matter what you're facing. And I want to further say, I don't care what you've done. Listen to me. If you don't hear anything else I say this morning, listen to what I'm going to tell you. This is for somebody.
Come on.
Something just this simple. Maybe you're online. I just want you to listen. I don't care where you've been, what you've been involved with, what you're going through right now, how insurmountable it is. Whatever it is you're facing, whatever it is you've done, I want you to listen to me. Hear me real good. God loves you.
Praise God.
God loves you.
Hallelujah.
Listen. And his eyes on you. He's not forgot about you.
Thank you.
He has a plan for your life.
Amen.
He has a plan for your life. Amen. Jeremiah 29, verse 11. God said, I know the thoughts that I have towards you. Listen to me, little girl. He knew you when he formed you in your mother's womb.
Hallelujah.
Listen to me, fella. God knew you when he formed you in your mother's womb.
Yes.
And he loves you today, and he's got a plan for your life. He hadn't forgot about you. And that's why you're here today. That's why you're online. You say, well, I chose to come. Well, you did choose, but God put the choice in you. That's why you're here.
Right.
You did choose, but God gave you the choice to come. He put it in you. And I'm thankful for that. 2 Chronicles chapter 18, and I'm going to read one verse of Scripture. Verse 1, I'm going to have you stand, please. and let's reverence God's word. Second Chronicles chapter 18 and verse 1. Now Jehoshaphat had riches and honor in abundance, and joined affinity with Ahab. Now let me read that again. Now Jehoshaphat had riches and honor in abundance, and joined affinity with Ahab. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. Father, I pray that your blessing would be upon us today. I ask for that peculiar, unusual manner and movement of the Holy Spirit. That there would be an anointing not only upon your servant to present what you've laid upon my heart to present, but there would be an ointment, an anointing upon the hearers, that every person here, every person online, those that you've given me the responsibility of, that they would hear, that they would understand, that you would move upon our hearts this day. I pray, God, that each and every one of us will feel the sense and weightiness and responsibility of who we're to be. And for all you do, we'll praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 You may be seated. I don't know if you realize it or not, and this thing's ringing and I need help with it, please. I don't know if you realize it or not, but we as a nation are standing at a precipice. I don't like to take time on Sunday morning to preach national sermons, because I know, as I stated a moment ago, people come in and they're dealing with things personally. They're going through life, you know, job situations, life. Maybe you've come in today and your husband left you. Maybe, you know, you've had a great loss, whatever it is that is insurmountable in your world. We can get so overwhelmed with what's going on with us personally that we don't recognize what's going on all around us. The other thing I think we struggle with sometimes is how what's going on around us can have such a profound effect on us. And how it's going to affect our lives on a daily basis. So I state again, I don't know, and those of you online, I don't know just how astute we really are. And how much knowledge we truly have of where we stand as a people at the precipice in our nation. America, and I want to say, and I say without fear, favor, compromise, I say it not to get the applause of people, I say it not because it seems popular to say, but I say it because I believe it's true. America has the problems, but I believe it is still the greatest nation on the face of the earth. America has the problems, but I still don't want to live anywhere else. And those of you that might want to live somewhere else, you've just shown me you ain't never been anywhere else. The moment you fly out of this nation and land somewhere else, you're realizing real quick how good it is to live in America. I want to stop right now and say I thank God that when I was born, he let me be born. I was born poor, lived poor, grew up poor, but I'm thankful I was born in the United States of America. Amen. I love this nation. I'm proud to be American. See, it don't have much to do with my personal life. It has a lot to do with your life personally. And all you got to do is live somewhere else and you'll find out. I've been other parts of the world. I don't like to leave America. I've sat in a van load of people and had a machine gun pointed at my head just because I was over there preaching. I don't like that. I'm not astute or acute to that. I'd just soon them keep the machine gun away from my head. You know what I'm saying? But I also want to remind you that at the core of America, at the foundation, you need to understand this too, at the foundation of America, there's a couple of things. One, our forefathers founded this nation on the precepts and principles, the truths, the realities of who God is and His Word. That is the core that runs deep, steep within who we are. And all you have to do is walk into any courthouse in America, and somewhere on the wall, probably in the granite, is still the Ten Commandments. But they did come so that you could practice free religion. They could have never foreseen the day that we see now. They couldn't have foreseen it. But at the core of who we are, our laws, our practices, our precedents, it was based biblically. Educationally, we are based biblically. Do you know every Ivy League school in America, Harvard, Yale, every Ivy League school, Brown, all of them began as Bible colleges to train preachers? Did you know that?
Yes, sir.
Steeped in who we are as a people is a Judeo-Christian value system that in a large way we've lost. And the other thing we are, I'm going somewhere, everyone stay with me. Who will give me an hour and 10 minutes? I'm only teasing. If you're visiting with me, I'm telling you today, I'm only teasing. I'm not going to preach an hour and 10 minutes. It's not going to happen. I promise you. It might be longer, but I promise it won't be. No, it won't be. I want you to understand, we are also not, everyone say not. We are not a democracy. I think some people don't understand that. We think, a lot of people think this is a democracy. We are not a democracy. We are a republic. You know what a republic means? A republic means that the nation does not vote on all the issues and laws and all those things. It's not everybody choosing what it's going to be. No, in a republic, everybody votes on somebody to go and vote on what we're going to be.
Right.
Do you follow me so far?
Right.
Just a little history there. So in America, what we do is every year we have what's called an election. I'm preaching. I'm going to get somewhere. Just stay with me. You think, what are you talking about? I'm talking about the fact that we have an election. And don't you just love it? I love it every 4 years when they run for the president. That's the big deal. When people are running for president, I just love it. This is just wonderful. And this year has been off the chart. Biden has just been a landmark year for a presidential run. It has been the most pitiful presidential race I ever seen in my life. Good God, help us. Now, I wasn't saying that to curse, I was saying that to pray. Good God, help us. It's been rough. All the opinions and the running of the mouths and the carrying on and the digging up the dirt and all the rest of it. I always liked that part. You know why I like that part? It's always funny to me that A world full of sinners gets shocked when they find out someone sinned. You know what I'm saying? I can't believe that they ever did such a thing. Well, what did you do? I want to tell you something. I got some things that's under the blood that I don't want you to know about. There's some things back here in my past, huh? If I ran for president, you'd find out some stuff and you'd be, good night, Troy Ervin did that? Huh? And don't point your finger at me, you've done it too. That's fun. That's always funny to me. I can't believe they did that. Maybe they can't believe it. It's always funny to me, even in church, when people sin, and you're shocked that sinners sin. Why are you watching? Why are you shocked? That's what sinners do. If you're a sinner, you sin. Comes naturally. You still with me? I'm having fun. You having fun? It's going to get better. Stay with me. We are a republic. A republic that was steeped in a Judeo-Christian worldview, steeped in biblical truth. And I want to say before I go any farther that at some point, and those of you online, at some point, please listen to me, at some point the church needs to stop pointing her finger at D.C., and realize if we're not Christian anymore, it's because we have dropped the ball. Amen. There used to be a day that just about every pulpit in America, you could walk in and find some man somewhere holding this Bible up and preaching the truth of this book. There used to be a day the preacher said you had to be born again and you had to repent and you could be filled with the Spirit. There was a day when we preached.
Come on. Come on.
Nowadays, the churches in America are full of humanism. Self-help motivational speeches to make you feel a little bit better about your sin. Huh? All right. That's my soapbox on that part. I'm going somewhere. Stay with me. And that value system was integrated in our culture. Do you know, in my life, listen, this is going to shock you. You can look it up. In my lifetime, we had a president. I'm not going to say who it was, but we had a president. In my lifetime, we had a president that came on his program and formed a 3 or 4 minute apologetic. An apologetic, defending the reading and use of the King James Version Bible. Yeah. Yeah. Come down here and look at you. In my lifetime, I'm 45. That's not old. You can say amen, especially some of you that are looking a lot older than me. I'm 45 years old. In my lifetime, I had a president of the United States that came on his program, radio program, and defended and made an apologetic for the continued use of the King James Version Bible. He defended it from a spiritual and literary point of view. Could you imagine what we'd look like today if we had a president that came on and said, I think we need to get back to using the King James Version? Well, good night. There wouldn't be no preachers left in America. I'm not saying you have to use the King James Version. I'm just showing you. As early as the 90s, there was a show on TV, The Heat of the Night. Remember that show? Prime time, The Heat of the Night. Remember The Heat of the Night? Come on, you gotta love Chief Gillespie. I love that show. And there was a guest star on one of the programs. And the guest star, and I don't remember his real name, I just don't remember his real name, but he was Roscoe P. Cotrane on The Dukes of Hazzard. Remember The Dukes of Hazzard? Just the good old boys. ever mean no harm. I mean, he was Roscoe Pete Coltrane. And in the show, he had murdered somebody years earlier and buried their body and never got caught. And now there was a park where that body was buried, and a park bench right over, real close to where the grave, makeshift grave was. And Chief Gillespie knew he had done it and couldn't prove it. And this guy, every day, he was an old man, every day he would go sit on that park bench. Had in his hand the Bible, and Chief Gillespie came up to him, and he looked at him and said, "The only salvation I have is in these pages."
Amen.
He held up a Bible, and Chief Gillespie and Roscoe Pico Train talked about Jesus and forgiveness through the cross in a primetime television program in America in the early 90s. Are you still in the building? I got 3 minutes till 11. By 11 o'clock, I'm going to preach. I'm just setting the stage. Are you here? We were this. Listen, children, we are not that anymore. We are not that anymore. Much like the kingdom in that day, Israel was divided. There was a northern kingdom, Israel, and a southern kingdom, Judah. Split right in two. And the northern kingdom, at this time in history, the scripture I read, in this time in history, the northern kingdom was ruled by Ahab and his wife Jezebel. And the southern kingdom was ruled by King Jehoshaphat. Ahab and Jezebel were as godless and as far from righteous as whatever existed. And they allowed to infiltrate Israel, the northern kingdom, false gods. And they set up idols everywhere. Jehoshaphat, on the other hand, was a king that wanted to honor God. Are you on the computer? I put these on. I can see close, but I can't see far away. All right. Can you, it's terrible getting old, isn't it? Can you go to chapter 17 and verse 9? I want you to hear what it says about the southern kingdom. Everyone say southern kingdom.
Southern.
Say Judah.
Judah.
Judah. Oh, you're with me. Listen to what it says. In verse 9, look at it. It says right there, "And they taught in Judah and had the book of the law." Everyone say the Bible.
Bible.
They had the book of the law of the Lord with them and went throughout all the cities of Judah and taught the people. And then fear came upon the Lord, and they had power and prosperity. And then God granted them, in the next verses, verses 14 through 19, this incredible army. So they taught the word of God, and because they went through all of Judah and taught the word of God, that they had the fear of God, and because they had the fear of God, power and prosperity came their way, and then they had a great army. Does that sound familiar? Sounds real familiar to me. Sounds something like America. Preachers everywhere teaching the word of God. People feared the Lord at one point. Even people when I was a kid that didn't go to church had a respect for God. They had a respect for the church. You know what I'm saying? Even if they didn't have anything to do with it. Because the word of God was preached and taught, power and prosperity came to America based on God's truths. We had a great army. You still here?
Yeah.
If I say amen, I know I'm preaching the right thing. I know I am. We need a revival of preachers that will preach the word of God. We need a revival of people who will renew their fear and respect for the Father. We need a revival where God once again blesses us and anoints us and God protects us. We need a revival. Jehoshaphat was having a good time. And then it comes to the verse that I read in your hearing. Man. Everything going good in Judah. And it says, Jehoshaphat had honor, glory, and abundance. Overwhelming in abundance. And he joined affinity with Ahab. Everything's going good till then, Elder Shannon. He joined affinity with Ahab. Still had some good times. They still navigated their way through. You know, they really wanted to go attack Assyria, and they were looking for a preacher that would tell them what they wanted to hear. That sounds familiar. They went from spreading the word of God in Judah and power and prosperity. And then he joins affinity with Ahab, and Ahab gets about 400 prophets together that really like Ahab and will tell Ahab whatever he wants to hear. And there's one guy that Jehoshaphat finally says, listen, you got all these prophets, but is there anyone here going to say what God is saying? And they found one guy, and Ahab said, I don't like that preacher. You know, when I first started preaching, you know how they, over there in the hills, Bob Hobson, you know how they monitored how well you were doing? They would ask you, young preacher, 19, 20, 21 years old, how's it going there, boy? How's the preaching going? Well, I don't know. How can you tell? And I'll never forget this old preacher said, one or two things are happening. I said, what? He said, if you're preaching right, people are either getting saved or getting mad. And I said, well, both is happening, so I'm doing a good job. Ahab said, every time I hear him preach, he makes me mad. Every time he opens his mouth, all he does is prophesy against me. All he does is tell me. I don't like that preacher. Kind of like the way you're looking at me right now. Oh, I love you. I'm so sorry about your hand. Here's Jehoshaphat sitting around with all these prophets. He's saying, just tell them whatever they want to hear. We have sprinkled all across America preachers just telling people what they want to hear. Let me give you a couple warnings. If you're choosing a church, I want you to listen to me. I think we ought to have the best programming, but if you're choosing a church to take your children to, the thing you ought to look for is, are they going to experience the presence of God? Amen. And are they going to hear the truth of God's word?
Amen.
There's your barometer. Don't make the choice based on whether it's Mickey or Goofy painted on the wall
right.
of the children's ministry.
Amen. Amen.
Now, I want to have the best children's ministry. We're doing a spread over there in the new building. It's going to be beautiful what we're doing for children. I think it's wonderful. But let me tell you something. I don't care whether they got big ears or whatever's painted on the wall, and I don't care. It doesn't make any difference. I want my children to go and experience Jesus.
Yeah.
You hear me? They need Jesus. Hmm? They want to see Mickey, I'll take him to Florida. Jehoshaphat joined affinity with Ahab. And because of it, Judah went down the wrong path. You say, what's that got to do with what you're talking about? I'm going to tell you everything's got to do with it. We're not in a a nation where there are kings and monarchs. We're in a nation that's a republic where we vote and elect people to go and represent us in office. You with me? That's what we do. I want to ask you a question. If that's true, then that means I have just little old, and what a blessing it is to have this, by the way, to have this voice. I'm glad we get a vote. Now, I want to encourage you that are online, everyone in this sanctuary this morning, you need to participate. And I want to say this morning, if you think that I'm preaching politically, I'm not. I will never come in this pulpit or never look at you individually and tell you who you better vote for. You better make that determination between you and God yourself. Amen. I got mine to make, and I'm not going to carry mine and yours. You hear me? I got my choice to make and what I've got to do, and I need to seek God, and I need to pray, and I need to ask God what He wants me to do, period. But I'm not going to get in this pulpit and tell you who to vote for. That's on your head, Bubba. Not on mine. Say amen. I'm having a great time. I'm not preaching politics. I'm just laying down a foundation to say this. In Judah and Israel, Jehoshaphat represented everybody, and he would make a choice on who he was going to join himself to. In a republic, we don't have that. What we have are individuals who get to go vote on individuals. Now, here's the reality. Here is the reality of what's going to happen in November. Here's what you're going to do. I know this is a different kind of sermon, but I felt so impressed. I didn't want to do this. I said, God, I want to preach something else. But this is what the Lord told me to do this morning. I'm going to mind Him as opposed to try to please you. And I just wanted to lay this out here. What you're going to do in November, not just president, everybody else, you're going to go in, and what you decide to do in that ballot booth is you joining yourself with them. It's an agreement. In the eyes of God, Elder Shannon, it's a contract. I'm going to join affinity with somebody. You say, I don't like any of them. Well, that doesn't give you the right to wiggle off the hook. The one thing that has absolutely and most affirmatively destroyed our nation is the lack of involvement in this process. And I want to say this right now with all the boldness I can say it, and as brash as I can say it, and as mean as you'll let me say it, I'm going to say it. If you don't vote, then for heaven's sake, the last thing I want to hear is you blabbing your tongue over what's going on in this nation. Keep a shout. Amen. If you don't participate, then just go along with whatever happens and smile and be happy. Amen, preacher. We're behind you. I'm going to sit down and say amen to myself. I feel so good about this sermon all of a sudden. I feel like I'm right on track. Jehoshaphat joined affinity with Ahab. Everything going good. And he joins up. He goes into contract here. He says, I want us to do something together, and I'm going to agree with who you are and what you're doing. And when I join up with you, I'm going to say, you now, because in joining affinity, in the Bible, it was a, everyone say this word, a covenant. Do you know what would actually happen in a covenant? Do you know what a covenant is? There's a bunch of different ones. There's a hand covenant where you shake someone's hand. You ever heard of that? Let's shake on it. Have you ever said, let's shake on it? Isn't it funny? Even all of our contracts are based biblically. There was a hand covenant. There was a salt covenant where they would exchange salt. You ever heard that? Yeah, you have, even if you don't think you have, because you've even said before. You've heard someone say, Grandpa, I said this one. You heard Grandpa say, well, that man ain't worth his salt. He was saying, he goes into contract and don't fulfill his duty. He ain't worth his salt. You ever heard someone say that? There was a salt contract. There was a shoe contract in the Bible where they would exchange shoes when they went into covenant. They would exchange shoes. I'm looking around. I think I'll keep mine. I like my shoes. You with me? But the biggest one, the big dog, was the blood covenant. They would cut two animals, slice them. Right down the middle, two pieces, and they would walk through what was called a blood trail, and they would agree together. When Jehoshaphat and Ahab went into affinity, they were going into a blood covenant. That's why you got to be careful who you marry. That's a blood covenant.
Right.
Huh? You understand? Even our marriages are based on that. You ever go to a wedding and they say, which side, bride or the groom? You ever heard them do that?
Right.
You know why? Because that was the cutting of the bullock. Lay the sides. Huh? And she walked between the two families. That was walking through the blood trail. That's a big deal. Gotta be careful with that. Still with me?
Yes.
Do you understand that when the Bible talks about joining faith and coming into agreement, it's covenantal. What you are really doing when you vote is saying, I'm going to join with this. I'm joining with this. You still with me? Now, I'm not going to preach politics. I don't particularly like either one of the guys running for president. I say guy because Hillary's more of a man than her husband. I just see if you're alive. I'm just teasing you. I'm only joking. I'm only kidding. Just kidding. I'm only teasing. Now, listen. I want to say something else real quick, too. Listen to me. I want to tell you something. There's good and bad on all of it. There are some things that the Democrats have I like. Well, I wouldn't ever like a lead balloon. Well, you Republicans in here. And there's some things about the Republicans I don't like. And there's some things about the Democrats I don't like. And there's some things about the Republicans I like. Hmm? Amen. I mean, we could really have something they'd get together on the good stuff. I found someone saw this thing. They, you know, you get them on Facebook. I've really enjoyed Facebook. Good night. Everyone's got an opinion. They're putting it on there. But I saw this election guide. And you know, I had a thought. I just had a thought. I wonder. Where's the roaming camera? Come here a second. You. Ori. Come here a second. It's 11:14, and I'm hungry, so I'm not going to go much longer. So can you put this on this right here? Can you see it up there? Can you zoom in on the paper? There we go.
There you go.
Oh, aren't they pretty? There's the two running for president. I just wonder. Because, man, even this election, they didn't really talk much about issues. They just raking each other over the coal. Hey, look at there. There are two couple senators if I ever seen them. Now, put the camera on me. Put the camera on me. There's another one. We've all seen it. Put it back. I got to look at this guide that people puts out. And I thought, I wonder what would happen I wish Donald could see me do this. We'd just scribble through their faces. You're working tomorrow. I wonder what would happen if we just scribble through their faces. Like that. And we just looked at this. Not personalities, people, sins they've committed, lies they've told, You know? Laws they've broken, taxes they haven't paid. I don't want to pay taxes either. I'm jealous. I mean, if we just scribble through their faces. And as God's people, say, God, what do you want me to do? And we just read this. Pro-life. And there was no face, there was no personality, there was nothing, there was just a, this is what I believe, and this is what I'm for. Support Iran nuclear deal. And there was no faces, no personalities, just an answer, what they, I'm going to make a suggestion that the next time people run for president, we don't get to know who it is, we just need to know what they believe. Wouldn't that be fun? Surprise, this is who it is. Now, church, do you know why we should be against the Iran nuclear deal? Because God told Abraham, whoever blesses Israel, I'll bless whoever curses him. That's what the Bible says in Genesis chapter 12. Second Amendment, I mean, that's not a spiritual issue, but it is a freedom one. But I'm not going to talk politics. Let me just say that I've been buying guns like it's crazy. Just in case. Hiding, you know? I got to have a gun. I'm only teasing. Kinda. I hope you still love me. Oh, the whole public bathroom thing.
Yeah.
That's why I've been buying guns. Jerry, help me, man. Help me, Jerry. Help me. Help me. Help me. Planned Parenthood. I don't mind Planned Parenthood. It's all the plans they've got I don't like. This one I don't care about, whatever. There's a few of these, just political. Traditional marriage. That's one we ought to think about. What do they believe in regards to that? Private school. I mean, we can now have an opinion about that. I think we ought to be free to do what we want. That's just my opinion, but yeah. Refugees. I think we need to be smart when it comes to that. Restrictions on the church speech. That'd be nice. Energy independence, you know. Those are some political things. But here's what you got to ask yourself as a Christian. Now, there's two or three of them here that really are issues that we need to think about. Now, I know the argument. Well, we really argued for pro-life, protecting babies in the womb. We put presidents in there, no one's done a thing. I hear the argument. Yeah, they haven't done anything with it. I get it. Here's where I'm at. This has nothing to do with president. Let's just talk about the abortion issue.
Right.
It's spiritual.
Yeah.
It's biblical. It's where I personally am at. When it comes to that issue, whether they ever get anything done about it or not, I still, personally, no face, nobody on the card, I'm not telling you who to vote for. And I'm not telling you that you got to wrestle with God yourself on every issue. You follow me? Are you still with me? Listen to me. You got to wrestle with God. I'm not going to tell you, you know, what to do. I'm saying for me, whether it ever changed or not, I would have trouble personally joining affinity with somebody that says, I'm for this. I would have trouble. I would struggle with that. Now, I can't tell you what to do, and I'm not going to tell you what to do. That's between you and God. And if you've ever voted for someone, I'm not saying you're going to split hell wide open before your feet are cold. I'm not saying that. That's between you and God. I can tell you this, that the greatest judgment right now that lays at America's feet is the blood of the innocent that's dripping off of our hands. I can tell you that. We have been judged over this issue, and judged from heaven, and not only that, judged through natural consequences. Do you understand that there are natural consequences to things? If you touch a hot stove, what happens? You get burned. Is that because God judged you?
No.
That's because you were stupid. You touch, that's a natural consequence. You know, sometimes it's not, I don't want your kids to get hurt, but sometimes natural consequences are good for children because they learn real quick, I'm not going to touch that anymore. You always protect them from it, and then they always get, we've not really taught our kids how to cope with life because there's no natural consequences. You follow me? All right. There are natural consequences of this. When you abort nearly 100 million babies, but now you've taken, you know, good 60, 70 million people out of the workforce. And the economy's going to suffer. It's going to be less tax. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Innovators and entrepreneurs and all the rest of it. You've heard that argument 1,000 times. It's a natural consequence. God will judge us because of the blood of the innocent. Now, again, I'm not going to tell you who to vote for. I can care less about the faces. But I will say, we do need to weigh ourselves and say, God, who am I going to join affinity with? And not just the president, I'm talking about across the board. Across the board. There's a lot weighing on this year. And I wanted to come in here this morning and as your pastor, take just 35 minutes. Talk about where we've been, talk about where we are, talk about where we need to go as a nation. And then just look at you and say, you have a responsibility before God to not just haphazardly vote, but you have a responsibility before God to pray and say, God, what do you want me to do?
Right.
It's not about a face or a personality. And honestly, you know, when it comes to the two running for president, I mean, I wouldn't particularly like either one of them that well right now. Now, I love them because I got to do that to get to heaven, but I don't know what happened. I'm trying to make you smile. Who are you going to join with? Better said, what are you going to join with?
Right.
You need to pray. And you do whatever God tells you to do. There are some issues here that are very, very important as Christians. Now, I mentioned the abortion one. I want to say something. And I want you to listen to me. I'm going to say this and I'm going to let you go home. It's a different kind of service, I know. But I know one thing. I'm going to walk out here knowing I've done exactly what the Lord told me to do. I felt it was my obligation, my responsibility as a leader of people to lay a few things out. And I've done it. So I'm going to go home and rest well. But I want you to listen to me. I mentioned that issue. If you've ever joined affinity with someone there, if you've ever had an abortion, I'm in a crowd this size, there may be a girl that's been there and done it. And you live with that. I want you to hear me. In no way, shape, or form am I pointing my finger at you or condemning you or pointing you out or making you feel something certain. Here's what I am doing. I am telling you that everybody has done wrong. And all of us ought to be convicted for sin in our life, whatever that sin is. And everybody can find forgiveness. And God will forgive you and cleanse your heart and fill your heart with a peace that passes understanding. And you can rest at night knowing that I know I did something I wish I wouldn't have done, but God forgives me. He'll forgive you of that sin. You hear me? There's still redemption available. That's good news. Or anything. All right, we've had a good morning. We've kind of outlined what we were. We, you know, looked at a couple presidents and scribbled their faces out, and that was wonderful. That was fun. A couple perspectives, you know, that was wonderful. Jehoshaphat joined affinity with Ahab. An alliance, and there's so much there about alliances, but he joined an alliance to further his cause as the southern kingdom and take out Assyria. But he wasn't careful about his alliance, and he paid the price when you read further in. And if we're not careful about our alliances, we will pay an awful price. America this morning stands at a precipice. And what we do is going to determine the big direction for our country. And I ask you, pray, seek God, ask God to move, and then you participate. And you say, God, you tell me what you want me to do. And he'll be faithful to put on your heart what you're supposed to do. Amen? Do you love me? Stand up, please. I love you. I do. I said I love you. I don't know. I mean, if you do love someone, it's kind of customary to say it back. Father, I thank you for what you've done in this place. I thank you for every person that's here. I've preached nationally in personal responsibility, just a little bit, just a few things. But God, there may be someone here that's going through something today. Maybe they're unsaved. Maybe they're away from you. Maybe there's someone here today that would say, there's some things in my past that I've really grappled with. You would say, I need a better life than what I've had. I need God in my life. Whatever it may be, God, there are people of all different walks here today. And I pray that you'll speak to them in a real way, personally. Let them know how much you love them. With every head bowed and eye closed, no one looking around. I wonder if there's someone today would say, I need God in my life. Or I need to take care of some things in my life that God's dealing with me about. No one's looking but me and the Lord. Who would just slip your hand up? Anybody like that in this place? I see that hand. I see that hand. I need God to do something in my life. That hand, that hand. I need God to do something in my life quickly. Anybody else? I see that. God bless you. Yes, that hand. God bless you. Those of you online, type it right there on your screen. I just need God to do something in my life. Anyone else, if we tarry just a moment longer. Now, without a big emotional pull, without a drawn-out thing, without a song even, I want you to know God is here in person of the Holy Spirit, and he loves you. He'll do something for you right now. If you need to pray, if you would like to pray before you leave, I ask you to come and meet me right here, just in front of this little assembly. Just step out and come and meet me right here, and let me pray with you before you go. Anybody like that in this place? By us. This will be our closing prayer. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Bless your heart. It's a little different kind of service. God bless you, young man. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody else?
Thank you, Jesus.
I need God to work in my life. I just need God. Let me tell you just a little more. Just a few moments longer. Bless your heart, buddy. I need God to work in my life. Just a few more minutes. Just a couple more minutes. Anybody else? Father, I thank you and praise you for each one of these gentlemen. You're working in their life. They've come. They're seeking you. And you said if anyone would seek you with their whole heart, they would find you. If we would knock, you would open the door. And I pray, God, that this morning you would do a work by your grace in these men. That when they get up from this altar, they'll know that they've met with Jesus. Jesus has met with them. And God's done a work in their life. Now, Lord, I pray that when we leave this place today, that no one will leave misunderstanding or upset about some political issue. We're not dealing with those things today, God. We're dealing with what we're going to align ourselves with. And I pray that as this congregation leaves, that they'll do what I've asked. Not just say, well, I better do this, that, or the other. But they will truly seek your face. And that they'll truly say, God, what do you want me to do in this upcoming election? Lord, I've done what you've asked me to do. It wasn't easy. Didn't want to do it. But I've done what you've asked me to do. And I thank you that you helped me do it. May each one receive it in Jesus' name. God bless you. Don't forget, we'll see you tonight. Come expecting good things from heaven.